They were bored, because they were flying too much. They argued about the merits of a four-cannon job as opposed to those of a single gun that fired through the airscrew. They argued about the climate of New Zealand, if it could be compared with the climate of England. They were restless and temperamental, as fighter pilots are apt to be. And it seemed always as if they would have been happier doing anything but the things they were. Capac alone did not do these things. He did not seem bored or irritable, or tired or temperamental. He did not play billiards, and he did not seem interested in the bodies of the girls on the walls. He was never asleep on the beds. He never played cards, or argued about the merits of this or that. It seemed sometimes as if he did not belong to us. He sat apart from us. And with his white hair, cultured brown face, clean fine lips, and the dark spectacles he wore sometimes against the bright spring sunlight, he looked something like a middle-aged provincial professor who had come to take a cure at a health resort in the sun. Seeing him in the street, the bus, the train, or the tram, you would never have guessed that he could fly. You would never have guessed that, in order to be one of us, to fly with us and fight with us, Capac had come half across the world. There was a time when a very distinguished personage came to the station and, seeing Capac, asked how long he had been in the Air Force, and Capac replied, "Please, 17 years." This took his flying life far back beyond the beginning of the war we were fighting, back to the years when some of us were hardly born, and when Czechoslovakia had become born again as a nation. Capac had remained in the Air Force all those years, flying heaven knows what types of plane and becoming, finally, part of the forces that crumpled away and disintegrated and disappeared under the progress of the tanks that entered Prague in the summer of 1939.